Thanks for watching this Magellan update. Today I'm speaking with Gerald Stack, our head of infrastructure. Gerald, it's been a busy year. Multiple Trump-related policies, Brexit, multiple European elections. What are the geopolitical risks that concern you most, and how are you positioning the portfolio?
Thanks, Frank. Look, there have been a number of political, geopolitical risks and situations this year that we've had to think our way through. There are probably three key ones that you've mentioned. Europe really for us means Italy. Secondly, the UK with Brexit. Brexit and some other issues that I'll expound upon. And then thirdly, what's going on in the US and with Mr. Trump. So if we deal with Italy first, political uncertainty has meant that there's some sort of risks that you can think about that would have impacts on the economy and on the Italian financial system. The businesses that we invest in Italy are either regulated utilities or toll roads. We don't see the long-term impacts for those businesses as profound, but we certainly see some potential for some short to medium term volatility. And as a consequence, we've moderated our position in Italy. If I move to the UK, we have the prospect of Brexit and perhaps the lack of direction that's come around Brexit. In addition to which, we've had the UK Labour Party suggest that in the event that they get voted in the next election, that they will nationalise the UK utilities. So with the UK utilities, we have to worry about the potential nationalisation. We have to worry about also a regulatory rate reset that's going on at the moment. Not a geopolitical risk so much as just part of their business. But the combination of those two events means there is some risk there. And again, we've moderated our position. In terms of Brexit, the company that it affects for us is Getlink, what used to be known as Eurotunnel. Eurotunnel earns a large portion of its revenues in sterling, and it has to deal with border flows. The Eurotunnel is the tunnel that links the UK and France. So there's a range of issues there. Again, we see the potential for some short-term volatility, particularly if Brexit is as chaotic as it would currently appear to be. While there are some short-term issues around that, we believe that the long-term economic prospects for Eurotunnel as a business are quite profound. And so we have retained our position in Eurotunnel accordingly. We've moderated our position in the utilities, UK utilities, but kept our position in Getlink as it were. So that's Italy, that's UK. The final piece is the US. In the US, we invest in US utilities, both electric, gas and water, and we invest in US rail. US utilities largely unaffected by most of what we've seen out of Mr. Trump. The tax changes had some effects, but they're relatively minor. Rail, on the other hand, has put some potential impacts out of any trade war that might eventuate. Rail transports containers to and from ports, there's some volume impact there. We don't see that impact as particularly profound, but it's something we're thinking about. Rail's a relatively small part of our portfolio, but we're trying to think about it. So they're the three particular areas that we've had to think about geopolitical issues.
So on the interest rate front, we've seen rising interest rates, and again, there's perception that infrastructure assets can sometimes be a proxy for rising interest rates. And we've seen some rises over the course of 2018. Again, how are you navigating through and positioning the portfolio?
Okay, let's recap around what our thesis is around interest rates, or our thinking is. As you know, there's a number of investors who would see infrastructure as being a bond proxy-like. We would take the view that as interest rates rise, they're rising because of inflation, and as interest rates rise, So the income streams that these businesses earn, whether it's a regulated utility where you're regulated at the point of earnings, or an infrastructure asset like a toll road or an airport where you're regulated at the point of price, that regulation means that you get automatic revenue or earnings increases, as the case may be, to reflect that underlying inflation. So an increase in interest rates is already accounted for in the regulatory system, and therefore the underlying prospects, the fundamentals of the business should not be largely affected by interest rate rises. So we're not particularly concerned about the fundamental component. We then have to think about what does an interest rate rise mean for valuation. Now our view would be that the fact that interest rates are going to rise, or have been rising, and we expect will continue to rise, is not new news. Market participants have understood this for a while and have built that into the way that they value these assets. And it would be our view today that the current pricing of these assets incorporates further interest rate rises. I think probably the consensus view would be that there's likely to be three more interest rate rises over the next little while. And that's largely built into what we're seeing. So we would see further interest rate rises as not affecting the underlying intrinsic value. Now, having said all of that, what we can tell you with clarity is that over the last sort of 3 to 5 years, we've seen three major instances where interest rates have risen in a relatively short period of time, and at each time, infrastructure as an asset class has taken a leg down. The prices have been hurt. So, and that's largely due, as we see it, to this view that infrastructure is a bond rate proxy. So, interest rates rise, there's this knee-jerk reaction, and prices go down. And as I say, we can say that with some clarity, and that's essentially what we expect. However, each time that that's happened, what we've then seen is that infrastructure prices have come back indeed to where they started, if not to indeed the trend line of where they were going over time. There's an upward sloping trend line. So we've seen this short-term reaction, prices go down, but then prices have come back. And they come back because, as I say before, the investment market is incorporating those interest rate rises into the way they think about value. So that you've got to differentiate between that short-term impact and the medium to longer-term impact. 2018 has seen that play out. We've seen interest rates rise, not as significantly as we saw in financial year 2017, but we've seen a continuation of that curve. And as each time as the interest rates have risen, when I talk about interest rates rising, what I'm talking about is the US 10-year government bond yield, which we see as the determinant of rates more broadly. As those rates have risen, we've seen infrastructure fall in the short term and then recover. So very consistent with our thesis. Clearly, if interest rates rise beyond what market participants expect, then that would be challenging conditions for infrastructure investors. But at the moment, we feel that the underlying valuations of these infrastructure assets incorporate a rate, an underlying base rate that's well in excess of prevailing rates. And we feel reasonably comfortable about where valuations currently lie for infrastructure assets.
So over the last 12 months, Gerald, how has the infrastructure strategy performed and what have been some of the key drivers, both on the upside and the downside?
So if we think about the downside, there are really two key risks with infrastructure assets. And the nature of infrastructure is you build a big, typically ugly piece of capital equipment. There's a lot of capital expenditure up front, and then you've got a long series of very reliable cash flows, reliable, predictable cash flows into the future. As a result of all that, you've got two key risks. One is that the government decides once you've built the asset that they're going to change the terms and conditions on you, and we'd see that as sovereign risk. And the other potential change is that real interest rates change more than you would expect in a long-term setting, and that really reduces the value of those future cash flows. So they're your two key risks. So this year we've seen some interest rate rises. That's particularly impacted utilities this year. We've talked about in the past that utilities, in our view, were the more challenged, and particularly US utilities, were more challenged part of our investment universe in terms of valuation. This year, as interest rates have risen, we've seen utilities step back a bit into a position where we would consider US utilities in particular fair value today, broadly speaking. So that's impacted. The second impact has then been geopolitical. So it's been around sovereign risk. And where we've seen geopolitical risks rear their ugly head, we've seen share prices take a hit, at least in the short term. We've seen that in Italy, we've seen that in the UK. So they're the two key risks. They've been the negatives. We've tried to moderate our positions accordingly, and we've got some of that right, but not all of it. But they've been the key issues. The thing that has worked has been infrastructure assets, toll roads, airports, where volumes and indeed communications assets, where volumes have been strong or reliable. Pricing has been as expected, given the regulatory formats. And therefore, you've seen solid, robust growth in earnings, and share prices do reasonably well. So the standouts in our portfolio have been infrastructure assets rather than utilities. Our positioning is essentially 60% infrastructure, 30% utilities, and 10% cash. So given that those weightings, it's meant that we've done relatively well versus the benchmark, and we performed largely in line with our thesis, CPI plus 5.
Thanks, Gerald.
Thanks, Frank.
And thanks for watching. As always, feel free to forward on this link to clients or colleagues where you think it might be of interest. Thank you.